Greetings, dear students. Today I am going to discuss the topic transmission system design. Means if we want to design a transmission system, what factors we should consider and what are the components those we are going to use. Okay. So this slide shows what are the main components those are required to form a transmission system. First of all, I would say, what do you mean by transmission system? Transmission system means a system which transmit power from one end to another end. Like that, we can say, if the power is generating at generating plant at Kota, and we want to transmit the power from Kota to Udaipur city, then how we will transmit? With the help of transmission system, we will transmit the electrical power from Kota to Udaipur. Okay. So this is the, now look at this diagram. First of all, this is general diagram for transmission system, in which you can see this is our generating plant where power is generated. Now this power that is generated 11 kV, that is stepped up from 11 kV to 132 kV with the help of transformer, and that is transmitted to this part, that is the grid substations. Okay, so this part is belonging from transmission system. With that, if another lines are coming, going for another city or another places, that is mentioning through this diagram. Now we discuss about the components those are used for transmission system. First one is support, second is cross arm and clamp, third is insulator, rise and stays, conductor, fuses and isolating switches, lightning arresters, continuous earth wire, guard wire, bird guards, vibration damper, jumpers, etc. So this is the generalized list for the components those are required for design a transmission system. Now we discuss one by one.
Okay.
First we start with the support. What do you mean by support? Support means pole or towers, what we can say. That means we transmit the power from one end to another end to the conductors. But to support the conductors for a long distance, we are using the towers. Those are known as support. There are different kind of supports are available. Those according to their manufacturing, we classify them. So these supports are known as poles and towers, which are depending on the size and height of the processing voltage. That means if we are going for a low voltage transmission of power, we would use a different kind of supports. For high voltage power transmission, we will go for the different kind of line supports. Okay. Now look at this. This is the diagram of RCC pole. Okay. We have seen in a general way, we have seen all these poles, those are used for distribution purpose, or up to 33 kV lines we go for the RCC poles. And these are the general diagrams, those are representing the RCC poles, through which those are supporting the line conductors. And these RCC poles are formed by concrete, cement, and these are strengthened by the RCC rods. So basically inner structure is having RCC rods and outer part is formed by the cement. And for high voltage side, we go for the support towers. Those are of different structures. Look at This is generally called high voltage limbo, but high voltage or extra high voltage transmission, we are requiring this kind of structures. Because when we select any kind of support for towers, we have to give the particular factors in our mind, like that the mechanical strength of the towers. Because when a conductor is placed on the towers, there is wind effect, there is ice effect, as well as the weight of the conductor is also there. So on that, those factors, on the behalf of those factors, we decide the, we have to keep one thing in our mind, that is the mechanical strength of the tower. So according to the transmission line or transmission voltage, the conductor size changes, and due to the change in conductor size, the weight conductor changes, as well as if there is wind, then due to that wind, vibrations would be there, and that vibrations will go for the, that those will move the conductors, and that may affect the mechanical strength of the pole. So according to that, we keep the one thing in our mind, that those will be quite sufficient, the towers would be quite sufficient to clear the wind vibrations, the conductor weight and weight due to the ice and etc. On the behalf of their mechanical strength. As well as since we go for the bigger transmission line, their cost is also one of the important factor that we discuss when we select the towers. In the earlier time, we go for the wooden towers. Now those are obsolete because those are having less aging. Due to that many factors, they get demolished. So we don't now. I'm not discussing that part. As well as we were having tubular poles. Those nowadays we have seen generally used for the communication system. But those towers are obsolete. Nowadays we are going for the RCC towers as well as the steel towers. Now, this is the diagram of cross arm and clamps. Cross arms used to support the insulators, because when a conductor is passing through a tower, it should not touch the tower. So for that purpose we are using an insulator. But how we will place the insulators? To place the insulator at particular location, we go for the cross arms, and that with the help of clamp we fix the cross arm with the tower. Look at this diagram. This is the conductor. If we are not using insulator, what will happen? That will come in contact with the pole, and that is a harmful factor. So we are using insulators, but how we will fix the insulators there? Then we will go for the cross arms. Why it is called this cross arm? Because the tower is having vertical projection, and this arm is horizontally placed. So this is forming a cross. So it is always cross arm. And this cross arm is fixed with the clamp. Here we are using one clamp that is fixing the cross arm with the tower. This is the general diagram. Look at this part. This is the clamp and this is the cross arm. Now we talk about the conductors. So to transmit the power from one end to another end in the transmission system, we are requiring conductors through which we transmit the power. There are some factors, those should be considered to select the conductor. First one is that should have high conductivity, so that maximum power can be transmitted from one end to another end with minimum losses. Because if the conductor is having not so good conductivity, then there would be voltage drop and other drops also. That will generate heat. So one factor is that if the resistance is more, there would be voltage drop. That means if we are sending V1 voltage on the sending end, then we are getting the V2 voltage at receiving end. The voltage potential difference between these two would be very high due to the voltage drop between these two ends due to the conductor resistance. So what's first thing? the conductor resistance should be very less, or we can say conductivity should be very high. Okay. Second one is the conductor's tensile strength. Because as we know that the conductor will be placed between two towers, that should be hang. In between those two towers, that conductor is having its arm weight as well as wind effect and other factors. So it should have sufficient tensile strength or mechanical strength, so it should bear that all these forces or effects. Okay. Third one is costing. Since we go for the transmission for a long distances, the cost is also one of the most important factor. We cannot ignore that part. And fourth one is the specific gravity should be as minimum as possible, because on that we have the weight conductor per unit distance would be less. So these are the four factors which we should consider before going for selection of any kind of conductors. In general aspect, we talk about the conductor, we can say copper conductor. So generally this is a good conductor. Initially we were going for copper conductor, then we were going for only aluminum conductor, because the conductivity of the aluminum is far ahead than the copper conductor, so we go for the aluminum conductor. But its tensile strength is very less as compared to the copper one, then the steel conductors comes into the picture. But nowadays we are going for the ACSR conductor, that is mostly used for transmitting the power or electrical power, that is in the form of bundled. Because in the conductor in the transmission system having many effect like skin effect, corner effect, to reduce all these factors, effects and losses, we go for the bundled conductors. And ACSR conductor means aluminum conductor steel reinforced. That means look at this diagram, that is having aluminum conductors, but its mechanical strength is increased with steel reinforced. Means one steel wire is also moving through the conductor in the center point. Okay, and that is about conductor part. Now we talk about the lightning arresters. In the rainy season, lightning strokes occurs and transmission system is spread out throughout the area, open area. So there is very higher probability that the lightning stroke should strike to the transmission line. And as we know that lightning stroke is of thousands of voltage, and our components are not of that much of capacity. So what can happen, that lightning stroke may damage the components. Because what will happen if lightning stroke is coming hitting to the conductor, then that voltage will flow through the transmission conductor, and in both direction, not in the generally way we say, if we are telling that the power is flowing from sending end to receiving end, so the lightning strokes waves will follow the only that direction, sending end to receiving end. But in actual practice, that flow in both directions. If that lightning stroke is hitting on a conductor at a particular distance, it will move in both directions. So, and with respect to time, that magnitude is decreasing. But since the lightning stroke is having thousands of voltage magnitude, and we don't have that ratings component, those can bear that much of voltage. So what will happen? Lightning stroke will damage the components. Okay, so that we are going to use lightning arresters. That means these arresters will capture the lightning stroke, and then that lightning voltage will be sent to the ground. Okay, so there are lightning arresters according to we can say road gap arresters, horn gap arresters, multiple gap arresters, expulsion gap arresters, and wall type arresters. And those are the basic principle of these arresters, that the how much voltage that is coming from the lightning stroke, that should be that should generate a, that will generate a arc, and that arc will be extinguished through those arrestors, as well as the voltage or current should be sent to the ground side. Next is fuses and isolation switches. These are the protection devices. Okay, these are used for, you know, when you talk about the nowadays fuses are obsolete because they were only working in the faulty condition. If fault is occurring, those will be used. Those will come into the picture. Now we are talking about the circuit breakers. This is a general MCB, but in the transmission system we don't go for the MCB, we go for the SF6 circuit breaker, DC vacuum circuit breaker, and other air blast circuit breaker, and other things. What is their purpose? The purpose of these circuit breakers is these senses the high current or faulty current, and according to that current they, you know, break the circuit, or they by opening the circuit they protect the different kind of devices used in the transmission system, because those are very costly. Okay, so what's the main advantage of circuit breaker? That means the advantage of circuit breaker is that those can be operated manually as well as automatically. So if in the faulty condition, if there is any fault in the transmission system, those will operate automatically and isolate the circuit, faulty circuit, from the system. And if you want to go for the maintenance, then manually we can close the circuit, we can operate the circuit breaker. So a particular part of the transmission system will be isolated from the system, and then we will go for the that particular part's maintenance. Okay. Another is the disconnecting switch, that is also known as isolator. Okay. This is also, since look at here, we are talking about a three phase, so there are three sections are there on three phase wires that would be passing through that part. Why it is called as gang operator? Because all three will operate simultaneously at the same time. They will make the circuit or they will break the circuit. Okay, that's what is called as isolator or gang operator. That is placed in the upper part, but that is connected with the handle in the downward direction. And what is the condition of its operating? Its condition operating is no current should be flowing. It will operate at no load condition. That means there should not be any kind of power flow, then it will operate. So it is used for, generally it is used for the normal condition, where, or we can say used for no load condition. If there is no load on the that particular part, means current is flowing through, if that part is zero, then we will operate the isolating switch and circuit would be break from that part. And after completion of maintenance work, we will close, by manually we will close this switch. Okay. This is the high voltage fuse cutout that is used for alternating current system. Means if these fuses are having conductor that can bear a particular amount of current, if the amount of current flowing through that part is exceed that particular limit or that bearing capacity, what will happen? That wire will blown out and that will break the circuit. So our system will be protected through high voltage losses. Okay. And with that, we are talking about the circuit breaker, we are having earth leakage circuit breakers also. If that, that means if there is a, you know, earth fault is there, if conductor is broken and going down to the, in contact with the earth, then that particular circuit breaker will sense the current, that will sense that there is some current flowing through the earthing, so automatically it will cut the supply. No, we are talking about the continuous earth wire. Tower or the pole is over the top of the line. Along the entire earth thread, the unusual circumstances created by the additional voltage discharge line to protect the soil easily. Protective grounding jumper installation for two pole and three pole structure. Grounded wire, we can say grounded structure, OGW denotes overhead ground wire that must be bonded with the work site grounding system, if within reach of linemen. Okay, OGWs may be bonded to the cluster bars or to the grounded face conductors with protective grounds. These are the, you know, earth wires. Means if any kind of excessive voltage or unwanted thing parameters are coming on the transmission line, those will be sensed by the earth wire, and that those earth wire will send that excessive amount of parameter current to the ground. As shown in the diagram, you can see this is the arrangement of the continuous earth wire that is you know moving along the transmission line from sending end to receiving end. Now we are discussing about the method of continuous earth wire. The most effective method of providing protection to the transmission lines against direct lightning stroke is by use of overhead grounded wires, as shown in the figure. For simplicity, one ground wire and one line conductor are shown. The ground wires are placed above the line conductors at such positions that practically all lightning strokes are intercepted by them. That is, grounded wire. The ground wire are grounded at each tower or pole through a low resistance as possible. Due to their proper location, the ground wire will take up all the lightning strokes instead of allowing them to the line conductors. The degree of protection provided by the ground wires depend upon the footing resistance of the tower. Now look at this diagram. This is a one. This diagram is representing only one conductor. This is the line conductor, and upon the dotted line is representing the ground wire. So, and that ground wire is connected to the ground with, and this is the ground wire resistance. This is connected in this ground wire is connected to the ground here. Okay. Now look at this diagram. Suddenly, if lightning stroke is approaching the transmission line, then since the ground wire is placed in at the upper part or at the upper side of the line conductor, so what will happen? The first lightning stroke will come in contact with the ground wire, and then it will be sending to the ground through the connecting wire. Now we talk about the guard wires. When a power line or telephone or telegraph line crossing, and then find the line that connect to the top and bottom of the earth wire is used to guard. Means the way we are, so though we are having ground wire, but we have to protect that the ground wire, because that ground wire is bearing the lightning stroke that is coming across through the lightning stroke. So we are using the guard wire that is protecting that ground wire also. Now the bird guards. Look at accordingly, you can see these are the components used for the bird guards. If we are not using the bird guards, that may be the scenario in a general practice. And what will, if you are going for the bird guards, what will happen? Those will not come in contact with the wires, because when they are sitting on the cross arms or they are sitting on the insulators, what can happen? They may produce dirty things over there, and that may affect the insulation capacity or conducting capacity of the components. So for that purpose, we are going to use a bird guards. Like according to this structure is formed there. Now we can see that now these birds are sitting over here, and this ground, the phase wire or line conductors are protected from these birds. Now vibration damper. As you know that transmission line having conductor, those are placed with the poles, and those are having, each pole is having a particular distance, so there would be some sagging between these poles, and there are always wind effect is there. If there is hilly area, then there would be ice, and with the ice there would be high wind pressure. So what can happen, the conductor may vibrate, and sometimes you know this conductor, if you are going for the three phase conductors, these conductors may touch each other, and that may cause a overcurrent fault or overloading fault. So, and it, due to the continuous vibration in the conductor, their mechanical strength affects, and after some time it may happen, due to the continuous vibrations in the conductor, their mechanical strength may goes down, and one day it may break down and that may cause a damage. When it is coming in contact with the ground, it may touch to that conductor live wire, or conductor may touch the any human being or animal, and that may cause a big damage to the society. So that to reduce the vibrations, those are caused by the wind and ice thing. Generally, vibrations are caused by the wind. To reduce or to suppress these vibrations, we go for the vibration dampers. Those are finger wise, this is the vibration damper. And how it is placed there, that is represented here. Now, jumpers. Jumpers means if one line is terminating at one end and another line is starting from some distance, 1 or 2 feet, then and we want that, because one tower is terminated here. Now we cannot form one junction, we cannot twisting the conductors here with each other. So what we can do? We cannot go for that another longer transmission line. Then we will go for the jumpers. Now look at this. For example, one line is terminated here, and we want to go for another line. Then what should be there? We will use one jumper that will connect these conductors. Now look at this diagram. Now, this is jumper. This is coming to this part because now conductor is terminated here. This is coming here, and these are the jumpers. Those are supplying the power from one conductor to another. Jumpers connection is connected via the two conductors. Nevertheless, as part of the face plate, danger plate, barbed wire and cradle guard, etc. This is the diagram of jumper. Now, another component is insulator. As I told you earlier, when a conductor is carrying a power from one end to another end, it cannot, you know, keep in air. It requires poles to support the conductor. But the conductor should not connect with the poles, because poles are, you know, going to the ground wire, connected to the earth. And if directly conductor is connected to the pole, some current may flow through the pole and that may cause the damage. So to protect the conductor to connect with the poles or towers, we are going for the insulators. This is the most important part of the transmission system operation. According to their voltage rating, different kind of insulators are used. Now, this is a classification of insulators. First is pin type insulator, suspension type insulator, strain insulator, shackle insulator, and air or steel insulators. One by one, we will explain them. Okay, this is a diagram of pin insulator, pin type of insulator. Look at this structure that is having insulating material only, and there is one group here in which wire would be placed, and that wire would be bounded with another small wire. Therefore, the conductor or line cutter should not come out from that group. Okay. But and in the another diagram, look at this diagram clearly. This is a group where conductor is placed. These are the sheds, and this is a cementing part, and this is a galvanized steel pin. Due to that pin, it is called as pin type of insulator, because with the help of that pin, the insulator is fixed or placed on the cross arm, and then the conductor passes through that insulator, and we can say now conductor is not coming in contact with the towers. Okay, but it can be used up to 33 kV only. For higher voltage, we go for the different kind of insulators. Now, okay, this is a diagram of pin tap insulator. This is a suspension type of insulator. For the voltage is higher than the 33 kV, we go for the suspension type insulators. That is a, you know, made by the different number of insulating discs used to form the suspension type insulator. And each disc is capable to bear the 11 kV voltage. So according to the rating of voltage, number of discs are decided. If we go for the 132 kV, then the divide the 132 by 11, then what we will obtain? We are requiring 12 discs for the 132 kV. Because when we multiply 12 with 11, we got 132. So this is general structure, how the suspension type insulator is used for the insulation purpose. Now, you know, the suspension insulator is fixed to the cross arm, and these are the suspension discs. And when there is one part is placed there through which the wire conductor, line conductor is passing to that part, and that is fixed with the screws. So that it should be fixed with the insulators. Okay. Now this new suspension is vertical suspension, that the conductor is suspended at the bottom end of this string, while the other end of the string is secured to the cross arm of the tower. Each unit of disc is designed for low voltage, say 11 kV. The number of discs in series would obviously depend upon the working voltage. For instance, if the working voltage is 66 kV, then the 6 discs will be used in series to form a string. Suspension type transmission line insulators suspended and support high voltage transmission lines. They are cost effective for higher voltage transmission. And typically replacing multiple pin type of insulators. Suspension type insulators have a number of interconnected porcelain discs with each individual unit designed to support a particular voltage, and that is 11 kV. This is a general kind of diagram or representation of the suspension type insulators. Okay, this is the arcing horn that is used for, you know, if lightning strikes occurs, then through that arcing horn, the arc will be extinguished. This is the conductor, these are the insulating disc, and this is the cement. Now it is compared with the, you know, pin type. This is the porcelain part, and this is the generally representation of suspension type insulators. Now these are the advantages of suspension type insulators. One by one I am explaining, reading them and explaining them. These type of insulators are cheaper when the voltage level is more than the 33 kV. Because if you use the pin type insulator beyond the 33 kV, its costing will be higher than the suspension type insulators. Since in this kind of insulators we are having number of discs, those are connected in series and forming a string, and each disc is of 11 kV. So as per the required number of as per the rated voltage, we can increase or decrease the number of discs connected in series. Third is, if there is any damage in any disc, then we can easily remove that disc and place only that particular disc should be replaced. Instead of pin type insulator, if there is any damage, then the whole insulator will be replaced. But in the case of suspension type insulator, there is no need to replace the whole string. Only particular disc would be replaced. And it provides the greater flexibility to the line. The connection at the cross arm is such that insulator string is free to swing in any direction and can take up the positive position where mechanical stresses are minimum. Because since those are, you know, suspended vertically, so where is the wind? According to the wind direction, those can move here and there. And then that will try to obtain the minimum mechanical stress position. If suddenly that if you know initially suddenly I would say if that power demand is increased and we want to change the transmission system, we want to upgrade the voltage level of the transmission system, then in this kind of insulator, what we have to do, we have to add the number of discs in the string only. Instead to replace all the insulators. The suspension type insulators are generally used with the steel covers. As the conductors run below the earth cross arm of the tower, therefore this arrangement provides a partial protection from lightning. Now, as we know that the conductor is connected with the suspension string at the bottom end, that means we can easily provide the earth wire or connect the earth wire in the upper part of the towers for the better protection of the system from the lightning strokes. Another is the strand type insulators. This kind of insulators are used at the dead ends where lines are terminated or corners are there, sharp curves are there where we want to turn the transmission conductor. For that purpose we go for the strand type of insulator. These are horizontally placed. Now look at these diagrams. These are the strand type of insulator where wire trunk is coming and line is, this is a dead end. Now if you want to transmit the wire in the further side, we will go for the jumpers. Now here we are using the jumpers and then these jumpers will come in contact with the this conductors. Okay. For you know this type of you know string type of structure is used for the system that is greater than 11 kV. If the voltage is less than 11 kV, we can go for the shackle insulators as the strand insulator at the dead ends or the sharp curves or turning points. Okay. This is a general diagram. We can see this is a structure of strand type of insulator that is capable to bear the strain. This is horizontally placed. Now their wire conduct is terminated here. Transmission line terminated here. These are the holding arms. Those are fixing the insulators with the cross arms. Now shackle type insulators. These insulators are similar to the strand type of insulators and also used for the sharp curves, end poles and in section poles, but for the less voltage, that is up to 11 kV. Now look at this diagram. This is the pictorial representation of the shackle type insulators. Here what will happen, if you want to terminate the wire here or you want to turn the wire 90 degree or under, the one conductor will come from this part and turning in that to the another direction and take the another way to move around. So this is the district where this insulator is placed. Okay, and these are the bolts where this insulator is fixed with the pole and conductor will be placed in this part. Now this is the stay type insulators. This is also known as egg insulators. You know, if the pole is placed at the dead end of pole, you know, basically this type of insulators are used. Look at this diagram. We have seen that kind of insulators many times. According to the structure, that is called as egg type, and according to their position, because they want to stay the poles at a particular position, that's what it is called as stay type insulators. And these are general structures of the stay type insulators. So we can different kinds of stay insulators are also called as egg insulators, are primarily used to prevent stay wires from becoming energized from accidentally broken wire like wire. Means if that is because you know to support the last tower of the line, we go for the stay wires. But sometimes it may happen due to any fault, if the live wire is broken down and coming in contact with the stray wire, then that will be the directly flow of current through the stray wire to the ground. So in between we are going to use the stray type insulator. So what will happen? If there is any kind of fault is there, but we are using insulator here, so that will block the flow of current in this part. So this part will be, you know, isolated from the flow of current to the that wire. Okay, and that is, you know, generally we have discussed the general components and their utility for to design any kind of transmission system. That's all.